It's very important to the process of understanding Google Cloud and passing the certification exam that you go through the question and attempt answering it yourself first. So pause the video, work through the question. We'll catch up in just a little while and I'll show you how I do it. This project scenario is an offshoot of the TerraM Earth case study. In this scenario, your agriculture division is experimenting with fully autonomous vehicles. You want your architecture to promote strong security during vehicle operation. Which two architecture characteristics should you consider? In considering the key parts of this question, one is that TerraM Earth is experimenting with fully autonomous vehicles. So these vehicles probably won't have a driver. They probably won't even have the vehicles coming into the service center on a regular basis. All of it is probably going to happen autonomously. While all of this is happening, you want to ensure strong security. And we need to choose two architecture characteristics that will promote security while having autonomous vehicles in operation. Let's look at the first option, which is that we use multiple connectivity subsystems for redundancy. Now, redundancy is a very good thing to have. If any of the systems fail, we would like to have a backup if it is very important. Say, for example, if it was a vehicle running that had, say, a SIM card connection to a local tower. And if it is very important to have that connection and it was broken, then there could be some problems. So maybe there is a secondary connection using, say, Wi-Fi to a local area network that has been created in that region. The problem with redundancy, of course, is that when you have more than one system doing the same thing, you're going to incur this extra cost. That by itself is not much of an issue here because they have not mentioned that it has to be extremely cost effective. So far it is looking okay. But then the more systems we have for redundancy, we also expose ourselves to a larger attack surface. If, say, for example, there was a SIM card connection to a local tower using, say, 4G and another one using Wi-Fi, now there are two places where there can be an attack and we need to guard against both. So the requirement of promoting strong security is not very strong here. Based on that, we are going to eliminate option A. Option B suggests that we require IPv6 to ensure a secure address space. Now, though IPv6 compared to IPv4 has some security enhancements, it has no inherent features that are relevant to our application as it is. So just shifting to IPv6 does not give us anything automatically. And therefore, B by itself is not a good option at all. Option C suggests that we enclose the vehicle's drive electronics in a Faraday cage to isolate chips. Now, honestly, I hardly know anything about Faraday cages. Still, it just sounds preposterous. So I'm not very keen about this option yet, but just let's go discover what this is about. A Faraday cage is an enclosure used to block electromagnetic fields. So if this system had a wired connection, I'm not very sure if it's going to have a huge impact by putting a Faraday cage around it. It might be like locking your building, but then having a wire running under the building that directly connects to your data center. On the other hand, if it was using wireless, then the data is entirely cut off, even for users that are legitimate. Either ways, this seems an excessive option that is just ridiculous, and we can easily eliminate option C. Option D suggests that we use a functional programming language to isolate code execution cycles. Again, I just think this option is absurd. We'll say just using Clojure or Haskell automatically make it more secure than using, say, Go or Java or C#. It doesn't. Therefore, option D by itself, just changing a programming language, is not going to have a huge impact or hardly going to have any kind of impact on our requirement of strong security. So option D is out too. Option E suggests that we treat every microservice call between modules on the vehicle as untrusted. When we assume there's no trust between every single module, these modules have to authenticate itself before conducting any operation. Having that in place means that we can eliminate certain types of attacks, say for example the man-in-the-middle attack, or if there was a phishing attack where some kind of malicious module is inserted in place of a legitimate module. So all requests coming from, say, man-in-the-middle attack or a malicious module will be turned away because it wouldn't be able to authenticate itself properly. So this is a great practice to have, and therefore E is looking reasonably good. So we're going to keep that and look at the other option also. Option F suggests that we use a trusted platform module and verify firmware and binaries on boot. Now some of the other options like the Faraday cages, those are just ridiculous and you don't need to go study any of it. But please do go look at what a trusted platform module is. It is also going to be useful when you study shielded VMs. So a trusted platform module is a dedicated microcontroller designed to secure hardware through integrated cryptographic keys. In the case of shielded VM within Google Cloud, they use a virtual TPM module. Either ways, it provides increased security to ensure that nobody has tampered with the firmware or the hardware and the binaries that are installed on these modules. Since these vehicles are out in the field and anybody has access to it physically, it is possible that somebody might try to replace the firmware or replace some of the modules, and therefore having a TPM in place will ensure increased security. Therefore, option F is also looking good. Since we need to choose two architecture characteristics, we have eliminated the first four and we have left with options E and F to ensure a no-trust boundary between every module that is communicating on these vehicles. In addition, on the firmware and to ensure the binaries are authentic modules, we use a trusted platform module as a part of the hardware itself. If you're interested in picking up loads more learning on Google Cloud, go ahead and subscribe right away.